Hey folks, welcome back. Chris Garlock here with Michael Redmond, 9-Don Professional, for our latest AlphaGo versus the world. It's our 60-game series looking at every one of the master versus, the world. Who do we have today? New player?
The human player is Chunlan Cup. He won the Chunlan Cup, so he's for that. So he is a world champion. But that was in 2017, so he's not quite a world champion yet. I think he's a 7-Don professional at the time of this game, and he promoted to 9-Don by becoming the world champion.
Mm-hmm.
So he is probably very close to the top of the world ranking at this time. He was born in 1993, so that makes him his early 20s at the time of this game.
Okay, let's see how he does.
The opening is going to be a bit different. First of all, Master has black. So when Master plays this pattern, Master is back to its favorite opening, you might say. Mm-hmm. And I think if White had now played a star point, maybe we would have seen Master play the big Shimari. Like it's played this move too. In a recent game in this series, I think we actually saw Master play this move, which is very unusual for Master, that is. It's a very human-looking move. So the human player at this point played this 3-4 point, sort of like mirror go mm-hmm. up to this point.
Mm-hmm.
And just trying to, I guess the idea is that he's trying to get Master to play a different opening and see what happens. So Black plays the Kakari here, and White plays, so far it's mirror go. And actually, I've seen this in human games also, like if Black presses here, sometimes you see White press here, and the copying goes on for just a few more moves, after which White's not really that serious about playing mirror go. Just in these two particular corners, White does want to keep it even by playing the same pressing move, which is supposed to be very valuable. Mm-hmm. So this is a pattern we've seen in the post-AI world. It wasn't around before that, actually. In the game, actually, Master plays this approach move. So this is a bit unusual. It doesn't really match with the things we've been seeing Master do so far. For instance, this pincer here. Usually when we study with AIs or computer programs that use the AlphaGo algorithm, basically, the idea is that pressing here is very valuable for White. And even if Black plays a pincer, White's supposed to be able to press at the mark point. And so pincers are not played very much by professional players anymore. It's sort of interesting to see AlphaGo play it here. Of course, the human players aren't pressing at the mark point so much. So in this game, actually, White invades here. So we're going to see a new move here. Well, not new move. This is a move that has been played by human players before. Mm-hmm. I think the first time we're seeing it here in this series, peeping from the outside of a star point. And there was a lot of discussion about whether this was working or how it works and stuff like that. It's very difficult. I think it does have a potential effect on the fight here on the lower side. And there is the fact that when Black plays that peep and at some later point in the game slides here, when White answers in the corner, this exchange does become an advantage for Black. It becomes an exchange that has helping the Black group here on the lower side at a very low cost, because White's connection here on the left, the marked stone at d5, is not a very efficient stone after White has played the 3-3 point like this. So it's kind of annoying for White when Black later plays the slide here. And so that's why this peep here that Black plays is a move that human players have played. In fact, it's a move that I like to play sometimes.
Hmm.
I get the opportunity, that is. So played that, and then Black played here. And actually, like for many of these moves, they're not really like, for instance, I think that the suggested move was more like this or like this. the suggested moves by modern programs like Lila0 or Katago are not really matching AlphaGo's moves. And it's hard to see how this is going, because actually the score is not moving very much. It's pretty good for Black at this point, but that's just because Black started with a slight lead with 6.5 point pull. White plays here and cuts. This is okay. Black extends here. This is the point where White made maybe his first mistake. Playing this move, this is a very stubborn move. It just doesn't look like it's the right move. It would be natural for White to play down here. And it's going to make this exciting variation. This is the suggested variation. It's close enough to even. But after White plays here, I think this is going to be bad for White. But I don't know why Black didn't play the tar here. I think I might have even made a commentary for you.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, I was wondering why AlphaGo did not play the tar here. If Black plays the tar and plays the hanging connection, it seems to be a more forceful attack on White. Like if White plays here, White can capture the black stones, but it's going to be fairly painful. Like Black gets all of these squeezing moves and then can live in the corner. If Black later plays here, it's actually the fact that White does not have a completely living shape. So this white group, will, after taking those four black stones, it has to worry about eyes also. And that's a four stones. It's a knockout de shape.
It is.
A dead shape.
Yeah.
So there's that. And like if White instead plays the pushing move here, then Black can connect underneath. And this is okay for Black also. Like White has the two stones, but this clunky shape here is not so efficient. Black is getting a lot of territory in return. And the fact that Black is connected underneath here, it gives Black a very strong position there. And that nullifies the potential of an attack here for White, which is one of the moves that White had wanted to try to do. So this would be perfectly okay for Black. It's really strange to see AlphaGo play this move, which I still don't understand, going down here. White pushes. So if White had, so Black plays a hane. In this case, if Black connects underneath like this, it's just that much more bad agi with a potential of White wedging here at some point. So it would obviously, the other variation I was showing is that much better when Black has this shape and can connect under this way. It's much better. Connecting underneath after this, at this point, was not really an option. It would be just that much worse for Black compared to the variation I was showing you. And when Black plays here, this was the game move. White could have captured the black stones like this, but Black is going to wedge here and squeeze like this. And again, the whole squeeze is going to be forcing. White has to answer. And it's very similar to a previous variation I showed you. White's going to win the fight to capture, but again, White is not 100% alive yet. So although Black has sort of, the shape is not perfect with this clump of stones here, it still is an effective wall pointing towards the right side. And Black has the initiative to play this move at 20, which is going to give Black a living shape on the lower side. So again, it's working for Black. It's good for Black. So White moves out, and now Black connects underneath. So this is the turning point. At this point, the game is already looking a bit better for Black. It's Katago was saying it was 57%. And so that's 8 to 9 points. It's a couple of points for Black. Not a decisive difference if it's humans playing the game at this point in the game. So we're still in the opening. But this move, it looks so natural. It's a terrible move. This was the losing move, I would say.
Oh my goodness.
When Black bumps against White here, it's already obvious. Like White has no good shape move after this.
No.
It's just so terrible. White has to connect here. This was sort of forced that White had to connect here. You can already see it's terrible shape. So the way White had to play was White had to play here. And it's perfectly safe because like if Black plays here and cuts, then white can take from this direction. You can see that if black tries to save that stone, the corner is going to fall apart. So that's perfectly okay for white. The fact that black cannot do that, it means that black is probably going to play something like maybe here. And then white would be perfectly okay. Like white could even play something like that. And white's connected up. So the order of moves here, by playing this move first, instead of playing this move first, and then if black plays like this, white can play here, and it is a forcing move anyway. Just that slight change of the order of moves. It was the same idea. White had the same idea, but this was just a very careless move. Like we've noted before, it is a lightning game. There's only 37.
I'm going to give him some excuse here. It was a time pressure mistake.
It was really bad. It was a terrible move, and I bet he kicked himself at this point. It's already obvious that white is messed up.
Oh, painful.
They should have had a video camera. I'm pretty sure there's going to be a pretty active reaction at this point. It's so obvious that it's bad for white. And black curls around. You can see white has to answer this because of this group on the lower side. If we're just looking at the lower left area, white actually does have a local advantage. So when white plays this way, white is attacking black in the lower left, but it's just not an issue when black plays here. It's just so bad for white. At this point, it's getting closer and closer to 70%. White plays here. The suggested move is for white to capture. In the game white played here, white's trying to get more eye space. But the suggested move was to play this and play this exchange and get this squeeze in the center. It's still going to be in the 60s for black. White can live here. With this sequence, white's alive on the side, but it's going to be good for black anyway. Like black has this huge moyo on the right side of the board.
He's got 2 points, a live group, and then no attack. I mean, it's
no attack. It's a very painful life. White does have a relatively large scale attack in the lower left corner. It's a lot better than you're going to see in the game, but still, it's going to be a win for black at this point anyway. In the game, I'll just show you how it turned out. It's going to go up to 75%. And it's going to look bad. Like, it's going to be pretty obvious that this is bad for white. White did live, but it's just two eyes, right? And black has this magnificent moyo on the right side. And after this, it's pretty hopeless. Like, black's probably ahead some 15 to 20 points before Comius, more than 15 points. Yeah, and it looks bad. You can tell that this is obviously good for black. White does not have any weak points to speak of against this wall. Like, none of the cuts really work for white here.
Right. I was just looking at them. It's like a flawless wall, isn't it?
Yeah. So, well, I might go a bit further in the book because white does invade that moyo and
scoops
it out. It's all gone. But whatever white does, it's never going to get... never going to get to be a close game. It's just going to be... AlphaGo has a unique way of taking it away.
Which is a good reminder, folks, that again, hope you're enjoying these videos, but for the book, Michael will be going into, as he likes to do, into some variations and taking a look and, you know, probably some more targeted kinds of things. And these are such great games. We have so much to learn from them I think all of us, pros and amateurs alike, have a lot to learn.
I learned a lot from AlphaGo, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So thank you, Michael. Thanks, everybody, for watching. See you next game.